1996, I spent a year at the Center for Advanced Study in California, and my compatriot psychologists there were Dan Wegner and Jerry Clore. And very quickly, it became apparent that Dan and I were destined to be friends for a long time. Our wives are incredibly similar to each other and quickly bonded. Our daughters are incredibly similar to each other and quickly bonded. And over the years, I've been lucky to spend lots of time with them and had lots of conversations with Dan, especially about sort of the philosophy of science, about how psychologists learn things and how the process of discovery goes. We've had these conversations in a canoe on the beach in the Caribbean, and lots of them in his living room. And as I was thinking with him in his living room about what would I talk about today, we considered a lot of possibilities. I left his living room with one theory, and I arrived here today with a different plan, actually, to talk about the process of discovery from a particular vantage point. So I thought Dan would think you would enjoy hearing this story, so that's why we'll do it today. So the agenda for our discussion has to do with, in some sense, a conversation that began when I got to Stanford about 9 years ago and listened to graduate students in social psychology at an area meeting talking about how frustrated they were that psychology, and in particular social psychology, was not as respected in social discourse as it should be. That in some sense, if you looked at the National Science Foundation budget, that the economics budget is 10 times the size of the social psychology budget or more. That in discussions that I had at NSF on a committee, a sort of discipline-wide committee, it was clear that nobody was troubled by that, that it seemed somehow appropriate that budgets were as they were. And as you know, since that time, which was a while ago, NIMH funding for social psychology has declined. And if we have so much to say about so many important problems, why is it that so many Senate subcommittee hearings happen without us? Why are we indispensable? Why are we not indispensable? Certainly, our discipline has a lot to be proud of, lots of important, famous people who have done important work on important topics, and we heard already this morning from Tim a wonderful summary of some of the latest work along these lines. But the fact is that when we look at the work we're doing now, it doesn't look like that much of the time. So what I want to propose to you in the next few minutes is one possible judgment that we have all made, non-consciously maybe, and how we do our work that might be contributing to our status, that if only we chose to do things differently, our status would be different as a result. And so to give you a flavor for this, here's the table of contents of that issue of JPSB, which we will not go through because we could certainly talk about these titles. But what I do want to point out to you is who the participants in these studies were. As you can imagine, they were. Not all of them. Some of them were, for example, patrons at a student's coffee shop, or college students, community members, and negotiation practitioners, or university professors, ombudspersons, media trainers, and negotiation consultants, or participants at the judo games, or children at schools. Only one was a national area probability sample of American adults. Now, on this committee that I sat on at NSF, as I looked around the room at sociologists and political scientists and economists and others who study social behavior, I realized that every one of those disciplines spends a lot more money than we do always getting representative samples of populations. For them, it's not a judgment call. It's a necessity. So if they are asked about our work, is it possible that we ourselves, by our choice of subject populations, are cheapening what we have to say? Of course, much of social psychology is based on college student participants in constructed laboratory settings with arbitrary stimuli, and we have developed basic theory in ways that we can be terrifically proud. We have a huge volume of great insights. But when anything gets contentious in public discussion, if there's an argument about how to combat racism in America, the reason we deserve a place in that discussion is because we're scientists, because we have data. But the fact is, we're going to run into other people who don't like what we have to say. And therefore, our data have to be convincing. And the question is, are those data that I just showed you going to be convincing to people who operate on a different assumption? Is it the case that the public gets the fact that we are identifying universals of human experience, and that it's fine to study college students because it's basically all the same in everybody else? Well, there are some among us who doubt it even within social science. You might know this quote from William Wells in 1993, who said, "As everyone knows, students are not typical consumers. When we ignore this fact, we can easily be incorrect. Age and education and variables correlated with them get inadequate attention. These powerful factors place student-based conclusions at substantial risk." And better known, David Sears in JPSP in 1986 said, "Undergraduates usually come from a very narrow age range and are concentrated at the upper levels of educational background. They have been carefully pre-selected for having unusually adept cognitive skills, and they have also been selected for compliance to authority." So Petty and Cacioppo say, oh yes, of course, it's true, but it's not a real problem. And I think it is actually worth reviewing their language. If the purpose of most psychological research on college students were to assess absolute levels of some phenomena in society, or the absolute strength of some relationship in the real world, then Wells's criticism would be cogent. However, this is not the case. Instead, most of this research examines the viability of some more general hypothesis about the relationship between two or more variables, and ascertains what might be responsible for this relationship. Here's the important part. Once this relationship is validated in the laboratory, its applicability to various specific situations and populations can be ascertained. So how often do we do that versus how often do we settle for the laboratory demonstration with the students? Ned Jones even said, "Since most of the experiments reported in this article were carried out with undergraduate college students as subjects, one might question the generalizability of the results. Experiments in social psychology are informative mainly to the extent that they clarify relationships between theoretically relevant concepts. Experiments are not normally helpful in specifying the frequency of particular behaviors in the population." We know that. Of course we know that. We've known that for a long time. Nobody would make the mistake of overgeneralizing from our findings, would we? Or would they? Here's a few little quotes. This is from the New York Times. When Danny Kahneman and Amos Tversky won, Danny won the Nobel Prize, the New York Times summarized one of their research findings by saying, "People shunned risk when gains were in question, yet people preferred risk when the alternative was a certain loss." Or Dan Gilbert in the New York Times, "While people think of their own actions as the consequences of what came before, they think of other people's actions as the causes of what came later." Just to show you I don't discriminate. Also in the New York Times, "If people find the subject compelling, they become engaged. If not, they answer impatiently." Okay, so yeah, each of these quotes is talking about relationships. But they're also talking about absolute levels. And even more importantly, they are claims of universality. Every one of us in those cases and lots of others that I found in the New York Times can be read as claiming everybody under this circumstance does X, everybody under that circumstance does Y. And you know that's not true. What you know is, in every one of these experiments, there's a statistically significant difference between two conditions in terms of the mean or percent of people who do something. Okay, so who are the people? Well, of course, they are almost always college students, and the fact is they don't even describe all those college students. They just describe enough of those college students to produce that statistically significant difference. So are we maybe going a little too far? Now, why would we do this? Why would we make these statements? Well, the argument is that I think illustrates nicely here. Here's the corrected New York Times praising Dan Kahneman and Amos Tversky. "Some college students sometimes shunned risk when gains were in question, yet some college students, perhaps the same ones, perhaps different ones, sometimes preferred risk when the alternative was a certain loss." Or the real Dan Gilbert, "While some college students sometimes think of their own actions as the consequences of what came before, perhaps these same college students, or perhaps other college students, sometimes think of other people's actions as the causes of what came." It just doesn't roll off the tongue as well, does it? So is anybody fooled by any of this? Well, certainly the fact checkers at the New York Times are. But it's not so clear to me that others are as convinced as we are that our laboratory experimental findings based on college students are actually identifying universals of human nature. Besides maybe the undergraduates. And let's just for a moment pause to recognize what I think of as a wonderfully entertaining little circle. So we do our experiments with the college students who are enrolled in our courses and required to participate in them. We write them up. We send them off to journals that are edited and involve reviewers who themselves do the same studies with their college students. And then occasionally, the Dans will identify one of those studies to write up in their textbook, which will then be sold back to the undergraduates. who participated in the first place. So could you imagine anything better tailored to success with our customers? In other words, imagine that undergraduates no longer want to take psychology courses. Well, we're out of our job, right? Those are the most important people. And how better to keep them happy than to tell them findings about themselves? So it's a wonderfully reinforcing system, except for Congress, except for the people who might give us a budget in SF and so on. Okay, so I guess my point is that we are certainly entertaining and we are certainly thought-provoking, but it's not clear that we are essential. And could we be doing just a little bit more to make ourselves more prominent in public discussion, taken more seriously, to have more impact, to improve the lives of everyone? So what are the implications of this argument? Well, what I want to suggest is collect more data from real people, and not just any people, representative samples of people. Maybe not because it'll change the results, although we'll address that in a second empirically, but because it actually will help us sell the results. It will be more convincing to the people who want to be skeptical about our claims about human nature. Now, it does turn out that we can explore whether basic lab findings generalize in order to enrich our theories. But we will also find out at a very basic level, is what we have seen in the lab going to replicate in those representative samples? And so you know that there's important work being done increasingly, including Dan's own research group, that create websites, welcome people to come participate in studies at those websites, and look at the degree to which the same findings appear. And yeah, there are heterogeneous groups of people, different ages, different places of residence. But we don't know for sure who those people are, and we don't know the degree to which they're there because they're just like psychology students. They're interested in exactly the same kinds of topics that attract those undergraduates to the classroom. So what we're going to do now is look at this question more broadly. And the way I'll do it is using a methodology that you can use for free today, and that is to collect data from representative national samples from a company called Knowledge Networks based in Menlo Park, California. You can do this because the National Science Foundation is pouring millions of dollars into a project called TESS, Time Sharing Experiments for the Social Sciences. You can write a 5-page application, and they will run your experiment for you on the internet, including with interaction between participants at no cost to you. So you can do what I've done here and what I'll show you results look like. The way they recruit their panel of participants is they have over time done random digital telephone calls to American households, and recently they're doing mailings as well. They invite a representative sample of Americans to join their panel. Anybody who doesn't have computer equipment or internet access is given it for free, and people agree to do regular surveys in exchange for a small amount of money. We have evaluated the representativeness and accuracy of the samples, and they have been remarkable over time. I certainly did not expect this methodology to work, and I've been really struck over time at how it has worked. So we're going to use this platform to replicate a series of experiments well known in psychology, some partly inspired by Kahneman and Tversky, base rate underutilization, the law of large numbers, the conjunction fallacy, the false consensus effect, a very basic effect in persuasion. We're going to look at a well-known interaction you might know about in the work of Petty and Cacioppo on the interaction of argument quality and need for cognition. We'll look at the basic Ash-type conformity effect and the impact of ease of retrieval on self-perceptions. Now, in the interest of time, I'm not going to go through all of this as slowly as I might, but I want to just show you, I'll show you this first one, and then we'll go through the others quickly. So you know the base rate underutilization paradigm that many have concluded. People ignore relevant statistical evidence when making judgments and instead are persuaded by case histories or individuating information. This is taken to be evidence of the availability heuristic. And so the question is, if I tell you about, for example, I guess I don't have the example here, but if I tell you about Tom W. and I describe him as playing with model trains and wearing sneakers a lot, and I tell you that he's randomly selected from a group of 70 lawyers and 30 engineers, what's the probability that he's an engineer? Who's going to make the mistake of ignoring the base rate more? Well, if you look at the literature, and we have, there's really no evidence of individual differences at all. There's no discussion about who might be more susceptible. But when we asked a series of judgment decision-making scholars in this area, who do you think would be they uniformly said, oh, it's the less cognitively skilled people, it's the less educated people who will make these mistakes the most. So if we see it in our college students, of course it's going to be even more rampant in the real world. You might also make an argument having to do with, oops, sorry, this is a hard thing. I'm not even going to try. Okay. That you might argue that the longer you live, the wiser you get, the fewer mistakes you will make. If you're really not good at Kahneman Tversky type problems, you're probably going to get hit by a bus before you're 40. Whereas if you get better at it, the longer you live, you'll get better at it. So in our design, it's the typical study. People are told that that Jack is randomly selected either from 30 engineers and 70 lawyers, or 70 engineers and 30 lawyers. And the description either looks like a lawyer or an engineer. And in the national survey, we see an exact replication of what we had seen in the laboratory before. So on the left-hand side, Dan, which button is it? It's this, maybe. There we go. So on the left-hand side, this is when the description makes him sound like an engineer. People say on average about 75% probability he's an engineer. When the description makes him sound like a lawyer, a little less than 30% think so. When you change the base rate from 30 to 70, there is absolutely no impact at all. Okay, great. We got through the first test. However, it turns out that the prediction about who will show this effect is exactly wrong. So when we do regressions, which I won't spend time walking you through, here's what you see. That the distracting impact of the individuating information increases the more education people have. And years of education is correlated about 0.95 with tests of direct cognitive skills. Furthermore, controlling for education, more mistakes are made the higher somebody's income is. So if you want to make the argument that these kinds of mistakes are debilitating, it's pretty hard to sustain that in the face of the fact that, at least according to this indicator, these people are doing okay in life. So to me, if we just stop right here, this is enough to say, wow, this was kind of useful to leave the laboratory, look at this phenomena in a different setting, and consider the possibility that if we push ourselves to say, maybe this isn't a universal of human nature, where will it show up the most? We can be dead wrong. And when we're dead wrong, it may lead us to a fundamental reconsideration of what this very basic effect means. Okay, so if I had a lot more time, we would discuss this in other ways, but what I'm going to do very quickly is just show you that age is related to this phenomenon as well. It turns out our beloved college student age people make these mistakes more than middle-aged people do, although those over age 60 do as well. This U-shaped relationship shows up in many of these experiments. So in the interest of time, I'm not going to show you all of them, but I will show you some good news just to make you feel happy. So here's the conjunction fallacy problem. Linda's a 31-year-old, single, outspoken, very bright person. The question is she more likely to be a bank teller or a bank teller who's active in the feminist movement? And you know, the right answer is this than this, because this is a subset of the first. So who should make this mistake the most, as you can imagine? So here's what happens in the national survey. 59%, a majority of people, get the wrong answer. 41% of people get the right answer. But as it turns out, I'm sorry, this is a terrible picture, but the wrong answer becomes increasingly common the more educated people are. So it's exactly the opposite, I think, to what I would have predicted. Okay, the law of large numbers. In which hospital are there more babies born who depart from by more than 60% from a 50-50 ratio? So in a hospital that has lots of babies born or a hospital that has very few babies born, if you understand probability sampling, there'll be more deviations in the smaller hospital. As it turns out, 30% of people give the right answer, 42% say it'll be an equal number in the two sizes of hospitals, and 28% give the clearly wrong answer. And in this particular case, education has no significant impact, but we see, again, what we see in other cases. The mistakes are made more by the youngest, who we love to study, and by the oldest, less so in midlife. Okay, now I'm really going to skip over all this stuff. It's the same story over and over again. Here, see that one? Nice U-shaped curve. Okay. Oh, now I got to tell you this one. Okay, so this is persuasion. Very simple study. People are randomly assigned either to read strong arguments against capital punishment, which we won't take time to go through, but or weak arguments against capital punishment. Okay, so this is an argument quality manipulation. And the literature on the elaboration likelihood model says that people who like to think will be very sensitive to the distinction between strong and weak arguments. People who don't like to think won't notice that distinction as clearly. Okay? So here's what we find. First of all, that the strong arguments are substantially more persuasive than the weak arguments. However, and this is the relationship between need for cognition going from very low to very high, and this is the argument quality effect. What we expect to see is a linear relationship or some type of monotonic relationship. Instead, what we see is the fact that it's the people who like to think moderately who manifest this effect the most. So what's happening here? So what we see is a situation where, in every past study that we've been able to dig up that claims to have found the moderating relationship that was expected, a continuous variable was never used. What was always done is a median split of people high and low in need for cognition. In a college student sample, where do you think along this continuum the median is? It's above the midpoint. So as long as you put the midpoint people in with the low people, you get the difference between this and this. But by no, even with a sample of 2,000 people, which is what this is, you cannot get evidence of the expected relationship unless you cut it that way. So I chalk this up as a failure to replicate. And I'm going to show you one other failure to replicate. This is, I find, amazing. So these are studies that started with Norbert Schwartz's group, where people are asked to remember either 6 instances or 12 instances in which they were assertive. And the idea is, you might think, thinking of 12 would make you think you're more assertive than thinking of 6, but it's actually really hard to think of 12, and so you say, gee, that was difficult. I guess I must not be as assertive as I thought I was. So the question then is, does this very simple design replicate in the general public? So we have people either remember 6 instances in which they were assertive or unassertive, and or 12 instances. And when we ask people how hard was it, the people who were asked to remember 12 say it was significantly harder. That's the manipulation check that works. But the dependent measure shows absolutely no difference at all in ratings of assertiveness between the two conditions. And we looked everywhere. We turned every rock over, every subgroup, every possible analysis, and we can't find the effect anyplace. So I don't know. There's a lot of published studies showing this, but we couldn't produce it. Okay. So in general, here's where we end up. First of all, most of the effects that we looked at replicated outside the laboratory with general public samples. Whew. Okay, we're not embarrassing ourselves too badly, though two did not. Secondly, most of the effects were stronger among exactly the people who have the attributes of the college students who we study. They're highly educated, they're young, they're white, they come from the Midwest. I haven't told you that story yet. But it turns out there's a Midwest effect in all of this, and they are high in income. So the last thing that we did is to compare the effect sizes of 4 types of assessments. The first is the very first study that showed the effect, so going way back to Ash or Ross, Green, and House or whatever. Secondly, a meta-analysis of all other published studies documenting the effect in our literature. Third, the effect size from our representative sample. And lastly, a statistical simulation where we used the national survey data and estimated what the effect size is among the people with characteristics of college students. Young, highly educated, high income, white, from the Midwest, and so on. And I'm just going to skip to the summary slide. Oops, come back here. There we go. This is the summary slide. So the original study, and I'm sorry I don't have little error bars to show you this, on average, and in every one of these instances, the very first study to show the effect produces a stronger effect size than the later attempts to find it. So Jonathan Schooler will smile. Secondly, the national sample always shows a much weaker effect as a whole. But when we do the simulation, just based on the college student characteristics alone, the effect size ends up almost as strong as in the meta-analysis. So my word of caution at the end is this, that my quote, Dan's quote, the New York Times' summary of Kahneman Tversky, we really need to be careful. Because, in fact, our studies are overstating the effect sizes as they are in the general public, at least according to this work. But more importantly, even if I'm wrong, even if this is wrong, I want to suggest that maybe we should all make the decision anyway to do our future studies with representative samples of the population we want to talk about, if only because it will allow us to sell the work more effectively to those who are paying for it, but more importantly, because I think actually, at least as I've shown you here, I find it leads me to understand what I'm studying better. That by being outside of that controlled laboratory setting, dealing with the heterogeneity of the real population, it allows me to look at mediators and moderators in ways that I wouldn't have thought of when I'm constructing the situation and when that population is so homogeneous. So I hope you'll take that into consideration. And most importantly, I hope within 48 hours you'll submit a proposal to TESS, because they would love to run your study. And I thank you for your time.